No, okay. So welcome everybody to the last lecture by Olivia Caramello. So it's my pleasure to introduce Olivia again. So please, Olivia.
Thanks a lot. So today, yes, it is the third and the last session of this course. So we will mostly talk about equivalences of toposes today, and so ways to build equivalences in such a way as to generalize, in particular, this classical result by Groth and Dick, which is projected in this slide. And also we shall talk about how to characterize important invariant properties of geometric morphisms of toposes in terms of morphisms or comorphisms of sites inducing them. Okay, so let's start with the topic of equivalences of toposes. What we will first present is a vast generalization of this classical theorem by Groth and Dick from SGA4, which shows the equivalence between the topos of sheaves on a small generated site and the topos of sheaves on a dense subsite of this site. So of course, it is quite important to dispose of means for generating equivalences between toposes presented in different ways. Well, for many purposes, in particular in connection with the bridge technique, since, of course, one of the crucial ingredients of these techniques is precisely the possibility of representing a given topos in multiple ways. In other words, to establish equivalences between toposes presented by using different sites. If you take the geometric approach to toposes through sites. Okay, so let's first of all recall this theorem by Groth and Dick. So what this theorem says is that whenever you have a small generated site and a CJ and a J-dense subcategory D of C, so we gave the definition of J-dense subcategory earlier in the course. Then what we can do is to induce in a quite natural way a Groth and Dick topology from J to the subcategory D, so to get a Groth and Dick topology on D. So in fact, there are different ways to characterize this topology. So you can either say that the covering sieves of this topology are given by the intersection of the covering sieves for the topology J with the collection of arrows in D, or you can postulate that the covering sieves for these induced topologies are those which, when regarded as sieves in D, generate covering families for the topology. So these two ways of describing this topology are equivalent in this particular case. In any case, we have this induced topology, and of course, we have the canonical inclusion functor going from D to C. And so we can regard this, of course, as a comorphism of sites, of trivial sites. Therefore, so this morphism is necessarily continuous. Therefore, it induces an essential geometric morphism. So we use the notation CI for, so here I write EI just to emphasize that it is essential. So we have this essential geometric morphism, and what the theorem says is that this morphism restricts to an equivalence of categories between, on the one hand, the sheaves on CJ, and on the other hand, the sheaves on D with the induced topology. So you see, one issue with this result is that it only applies to dense subcategories. So of course, in practice, one would like to have something more general than a dense subcategory, and still have some comparison results between the corresponding categories of sheets. Therefore, the idea is to introduce some more general denseness conditions which do not require the factor to be full and faithful or not even faithful. So we are going to, in order to prepare the ground for our generalization of Grothendieck result, we are going to introduce some general denseness conditions. Okay, so here we are. So we shall introduce local versions of the faithfulness, fullness, and denseness conditions as follows, as in this definition. So supposing that we have a functor between two categories which are equipped with Grothendieck topologies, it is natural to define a relative notion of faithfulness in this way. So you see, classical faithfulness says that if you have equality between the images of two arrows, two parallel arrows under the functor, then the arrows itself themselves should be equal. So here, what we do is to replace strict equality by local equality. So we can do it both at the level of D and at the level of C. So in the case of D, of course, we use the local equality with respect to the Grothendieck topology K. In the case of C, we use the local equality with respect to J. And so we have different relative notions of faithfulness according to whether we decide to replace strict equality by local equality just on the domain or also at the level of the codomain category. So we have a notion of JK faithfulness and a notion of J faithfulness. So similarly, we can define relative notions of fullness. So you see again, fullness classically means that any arrow between the images of two objects in the domain category under the functor is the image of under the functor of an arrow in the source category. So here, of course, we don't require this to hold for the arrow, but only to hold locally. So we require the existence of a J-covering family to the object X, and of arrows GI defined on such objects XI, which realize this form of fullness. So again, here you see you can either require these equalities between the arrows G compose F, Fi, and F, Gi. You can require either the strict equality or just the local equality with respect to the topology J. So this gives, yeah, one second. So this gives different variants on these notions of fullness. And then we have the notion of denseness, which is, you see, what naturally generalizes the condition that we have for a full dense subcategory in Grothendieck's comparison lemma. K denseness means that every object of D can be K covered by a family of arrows whose domains lie in the image of the functor. Okay, now in terms of these notions, we can reformulate the classical notion of dense functor by saying that a dense functor is a functor which, a dense functor between sides, is a functor which is J faithful, J full, and K dense. and preserves and reflects covering families. By reflecting covering families, I do not mean that it satisfies the covering lifting property, but just that if the image of a sieve is covering, then the sieve itself should be covering. Okay, so some remarks about this notion. In fact, if we consider dense morphisms of sites, in fact, this faithfulness condition is redundant, because in fact, it follows from the preservation and the reflection of covering families, and the latter condition in the definition of morphism of sites. So we can, let me try to show what we use. So we have to come back to the notion of morphism of sites. Yes, here we are. So it is the fourth condition. So as you can see here, you see it concerns pairs of parallel arrows, which you see satisfy this condition with respect to some generalized element. So you see by using this, as well as the preservation and cover reflection of families, one can prove the redundancy of the J faithfulness condition. Okay, here we are. So it's important to make this remark, because then when we are going to characterize the dense morphisms of sites, we are going to skip the verification of the faithfulness condition. Okay, so the notion of dense morphism of sites is of course relevant, because as it was shown by Schulman in a paper, whenever we have a dense morphism of sites, this will induce an equivalence of topologies, as you can expect. Still, the problem with the notion of dense morphism of sites is that you might have morphisms of sites generating, inducing an equivalence of topologies which are not dense. So we shall present an example of that. So this means that we need to introduce a more refined notion of denseness, which we shall call weak denseness, in order to characterize the morphisms of sites that induce equivalences at the topos level. Okay, so what's the idea behind this notion of weakly dense morphism of sites? Well, first of all, we have to recall what a subcanonical Grothendieck topology is, because this notion will be crucial for our analysis. So we say that a Grothendieck topology is subcanonical if all the representables are sheaves. So in particular, recall the construction of the induced topology on a separating set of objects for a topos. So induced from the canonical topology of a topos. So all these topologies are subcanonical. It's quite easy to see it. This follows in particular from the equivalence between the Grothendieck topos and the sheaves on it with respect to the canonical topology, which is induced by the Yonida lemma. We know that we can generate subcanonical topologies by inducing canonical topologies on separating sets of objects for the topos. So this is important because we are precisely going to exploit this. So in fact, in our strategy to characterize the morphisms inducing equivalences of topologies, we have two steps. So the idea is to first consider what happens if the target site is subcanonical. So we are able to prove that if the target site is subcanonical, then if a morphism induces an equivalence, then it is dense. So basically, this shows that if the target site is subcanonical, then the notion of weak denseness will coincide with the denseness. The problem is that, of course, there are sites that are not subcanonical, and for them, the coincidence between the two notions will no longer hold. So the idea is to associate with our arbitrary target site a Morita equivalent site, which will be subcanonical, and which will allow us to regard our morphism F as a morphism taking values in this subcanonical site without changing the associated geometric morphism. Then we will be able to deduce from the fact that the morphism induced by F is an equivalence, we will be able to deduce that this modified morphism in the subcanonical site is dense, and then we will rephrase this condition directly in terms of F, and this will give rise to our notion of weak denseness. So this is the general strategy that now we are going to implement. Okay, so what is the subcanonical Morita equivalent site that we are going to associate with our given site? Well, we use the following obvious construction. So for any small generated site CJ, we can consider the canonical functor going from the category underlying the site to the topos. And we can take the full dense subcategory of the topos on the objects coming from the site. So the objects in the image of this canonical functor. So of course, this actually defines a separating set of objects for the topos, because as we have recalled in the first lecture of the course, if you take the images of objects coming from the site under the canonical functor, you get a separating set of objects. Okay, therefore, if we induce the canonical topology on the topos on this full subcategory, we indeed get a subcanonical topology. So we are going to denote this topology by CCJ. So we are not going to apply this to the domain site, but we are going to apply it to the codomain site of our morphism. So our codomain site is DK, so we replace DK with AK of D with this subcanonical induced topology. Then, of course, we observe that indeed this is a Morita equivalent site because, in fact, this morphism of sites, which is just the restriction of the canonical functor to the topos of sheaves on DK, so this induces clearly an equivalence between the corresponding toposes. And therefore, we can actually, by composing our original functor F with this morphism L prime, sorry, there is a typo here, so it is L prime instead of L. By composing it with L prime, we get a morphism of sites which induces the same geometric morphism up to equivalence, but whose target site is subcanonical. Okay, so this, of course, motivates the following definition. A morphism of site F is weakly dense if the composite of it with the canonical functor is dense. Okay, so the nice thing about this this definition is that it admits an explicit characterization. So it is possible to characterize this notion by using the local description of arrows in a Grothendieck topos, which we have presented in the previous lectures of the course. So remember that arrows, in particular arrows between objects coming from the site, could be locally represented in terms of families of arrows coming from the site. So by using this and other considerations, it is possible to characterize in a fully explicit way the morphisms of sites that are weakly dense. So in fact, this is the proposition providing this explicit characterization. So as you can see, there are three conditions because you see in the notion of dense morphism of sites, there were just three conditions plus the redundant local faithfulness condition. So you see these three conditions were cover, preservation, and reflection, which in fact is the first, as you can see. And in fact, this is the same as for classical denseness, because you see nothing changes by going from denseness to weak denseness, just because you see you have the associated shift functor, and the associated shift functor sends a family of arrows coming from the site to an epimorphic family, if and only if this family of arrows is covering. In the given category. So you see there is no difference concerning this cover, preservation, and reflection. On the other hand, you see the difference between the two notions of weak denseness and denseness in conditions 2 and 3, which are respectively the denseness condition and the local fullness condition. So as you can see, they acquire much more sophisticated expressions. So you see, for instance, in the case of denseness, you see that you no longer require any object of D to be covered by a family of arrows whose domains are objects in the image of the functor, but you require something weaker than that. So you require this in a sense to hold only locally. You see that you require the existence of a family of covering seeds which make this true. But you see this is a form of local truth rather than global truth. And in general is not equivalent to the dense equivalent of that. And similarly for the fullness condition, you see in the fullness condition, so normally what you would look at is the arrows from f of x to f of y, you see. Here instead, what you have to look for is the arrows from L prime of f of x to L prime of f of y. And of course, this can only be locally represented in terms of arrows coming from the site, which explains why the condition becomes more sophisticated. But still, what I would like to stress is that the characterizations are fully explicit. So they can actually be used in practice. You can verify them. Of course, they are pretty refined because as you can see, in many places, we have these local equality conditions appearing rather than strict equality. But you see, the idea is that we are just replacing absolute notions with relative notions, but we do this both on the level of the domain and at the level of the codomain site, which makes, of course, things quite technically non-trivial. Okay, anyway, this is what we wanted to achieve because, in fact, we can conclude the following result. So if we have a morphism of small generated sites, then the property of the geometric morphism induced by it to be an equivalence can be reformulated either as the condition that L prime composed with F be dense morphism of sites, or more explicitly as the condition that F should be a weakly dense morphism of sites in the sense of the above characterization. Of course, it's important for the applications to remark that if the topology on the target site is subcanonical, which of course arises in a number of applications, as we are going to see, then in fact we can avoid this more sophisticated notion of weak denseness, because the property of inducing an equivalence is precisely equivalent to being dense. So in fact the notion of weak denseness is only relevant for non-subcanonical target sites. So we can apply this result, which of course represents a generalization of the comparison lemma, to J-continuous flat functors, because you see, normally we present geometric morphisms as induced by J-continuous flat functors. Of course, we can regard any such functor as a morphism of sites. Of course, you see, I emphasized in the previous lectures that we had decided to work in the context of small generated sites rather than just small sites for technical reasons. Here you see one reason for doing that, because you see we have an interest in considering the canonical site of a topos, given by itself endowed with the canonical topology. Of course, this is not a small site, but it is always a small generated site. And so it's important to develop the theory at this general level of small generated sites in order to be able, in particular, to regard any flat continuous functor as a morphism of sites. So this means we can apply the previous theorem to which concerns the morphisms of sites to flat J-continuous functors, and this is what we get. So we get the criterion for the geometric morphism induced by a flat functor to be an equivalence. So as you can see here, it simplifies greatly, because you see we are in presence of a subcanonical target site, because it is the canonical site of the topos. And so, so the condition we have to require is simply denseness. And so if we read it, so we get, of course, the first condition, which is the cover reflection, because of course the cover preservation is guaranteed by J continuity. Then we have the denseness condition, which is the fact that the family of objects in the image of the functor should yield a separating family for the topos. And then we have the local fullness condition, which in the simplified form, because the target site is subcanonical. So as you can see, this is very, very pleasant, because all these conditions are quite easy to verify in practice. Okay, so still it is nice to reflect on the articulation between these two different notions of denseness. On the one hand, classical denseness, on the other, weak denseness. So in fact, here is a counterexample which shows that indeed, in general, these two notions do not coincide. So I have decided to provide a most simple example in order to illustrate how, even in very simple cases, the two notions do not coincide. So here, so let's briefly discuss this example. So suppose that we have the pre-order category 2. So it is a category with two distinct objects, 0 and 1, and just one arrow going from 0 to 1, apart from the identities. So we can equip this category with the atomic topology, which we introduced earlier in the course. So the covering sieves are the non-empty ones. Then we consider the functor F from 2 to 2, which sends everything to 1. Mm? So it sends 0 to 1 and 1 to 1. And the arrow from 0 to 1 to the identity arrow on 1. So notice that actually 2 is a meta semilattice, so it is a Cartesian category, because Cartesian pre-order poset categories are precisely meet semilattices. So our functor actually is a meet semilattice homomorphism. Therefore, it is Cartesian, and it is clearly cover preserving. So it is a morphism of sides. But if we look at the geometric morphism induced by it, well, this necessarily must be an equivalence because our topos of sheaves on this atomic site is equivalent to the topos of sets. Why? Well, because you can apply the comparison lemma by choosing as a dense subcategory just the subcategory formed by the unique object zero. And of course, when you induce the topology on that, you get the trivial topology. And so you see that we have an equivalence with the topos of sets. Now, we have observed we have recalled in the first lecture of the course that given a topos, given any topos, there exists just one up to isomorphism, geometric morphism from it to the topos of sets. So of course, in this case, there is just one such morphism, which is the identity. Mm? So it is necessarily an equivalence. And so we see that our morphism of sides F induces an equivalence. And therefore, the functor F is a weakly dense morphism of sides. However, F is not a dense morphism of sides because it is not dense for the atomic topology. Because you see, if you take zero regarded as an object of the target category, well, it is not covered with respect to the atomic topology by objects in the image of the functor. Because you see, all the objects in the image of the functor is just one. Mm? So of course, you don't have any arrows from one to zero. Mm? And so you see that indeed the notion of, so this is an example which illustrates the fact that the denseness condition for L prime composed with F is not equivalent to the denseness condition for F. Mm? So you see, if we come back to our characterization, so it was the second condition here. The second condition of the proposition, which is, of course, satisfied in our example, but the stronger notion of K denseness is not. Mm? Okay, so here is this example, but from a theoretical viewpoint, it is interesting to further elaborate on this relation between the two denseness conditions. So in order to clarify this relation, we consider the following functor. So whenever we have a morphism of sites, of course we have an induced functor between these full subcategories of the two toposes, AJC and AKD. Which is simply given by the restriction of the inverse image of the associated induced geometric morphism. Of course, this morphism of sites induces the same geometric morphism as the original morphism of sites. And it is interesting to relate properties of local faithfulness or local fullness or denseness of the functor F with the corresponding properties for the morphism AF. So this is what the proposition here achieves. So what the proposition tells us, and this is interesting because it appears the covering lifting property here in order to relate these conditions. So concerning faithfulness, actually the two properties are equivalent. So F is relatively faithful if and only if AF is. But concerning fullness and denseness, things are more complicated, as we have seen, because in fact, remember that the counterexample was precisely failing because of this inequivalence between this notion of denseness. But what happens is that, well, in one direction, one can easily show that if AF is full, then F is JK full. But what is interesting is the converse direction, which holds if F satisfies the covering lifting property. So it means that if we have this additional condition, then actually the two conditions for denseness and weak denseness coincide. And this is not only true for local fullness, but also for denseness as part three of the proposition states. So again, you can see that, well, of course it is always true that if F is K-dense, then AF is CKD-dense. This is completely straightforward, of course. But the interesting direction is the converse one, and it holds if F satisfies the covering lifting property. Now, so this proposition already shows that the covering lifting property might be an important discriminant between the notions of denseness and weak denseness. And indeed, one can show that every dense morphism of sites satisfies the covering lifting property. And so by using this as well as the proposition, one can show this corollary, which characterize the dense morphisms of sites as the weakly dense ones, which moreover have the covering lifting property. So this is quite satisfactory because it definitely clarifies the articulation between the two notions, especially because you see the covering lifting property is the property in the notion of comorphism of sites. So it is a property that is easily checked. Of course, this corollary also illustrates the big difference between the two notions, because of course, when you have a morphism of sites, there is no reason why this should satisfy the covering lifting property. Because this would mean that it is also a comorphism of sites, which is a quite strong condition after all. So it shows that in fact, the greatest majority of weakly dense morphisms actually are not dense. So it is actually a significant notion that cannot be ignored. Okay, very good. So concerning this topic of dense conditions, we have established the results we wanted. So now I would like to present a criterion for two sites to give rise to equivalent toposes. So a theorem which actually follows as a corollary of the results that we have obtained so far in a quite easy way, and which is interesting in its own right because it is a criterion that can be effectively applied in practice. So what does this say? Well, it characterizes the property of the topposes of sheaves on the two sides to be equivalent in terms of the existence of a third category where one can send the two categories underlying the sides in a dense way. Mm? So basically what part two of the theorem says is that there should be a category which can be supposed essentially small if the categories C and D underlying the sides are essentially small. So there exists a category where one can map the two functors H and K in such a way that some denseness conditions are satisfied. So you see the first one and two are the usual cover preservation and cover reflection properties. And then we have the other denseness conditions, because in fact, the conditions that we require on H and K are precisely that they should give rise to dense morphisms of sites to AZ, where Z is some Grothendieck topology on A. Mm? So whatever Grothendieck topology you want. Mm? So in fact, how does this proof work? Well, it is quite easy to see because, in fact, as I have mentioned, the conditions of the theorem are precisely those for the functors H and K to define dense morphisms of sites to a given common site AZ. So, of course, it is clear that if we do have such dense morphisms of sites, then of course they will induce equivalences at the topos level. So we will have that sheaves on CJ is equivalent to sheaves on AZ. And on the other hand, we will have that sheaves on DK is equivalent to sheaves on AZ. And therefore, by transitivity, we can conclude that the toposes of sheaves on our two sides are equivalent. So in the converse direction, of course, there are various possibilities for choosing a suitable category A with the Grothendieck topology set on it. But one particularly natural choice that one can make is to take the full subcategory of the common topos, because here we are supposing that they give rise to the same topos. So we consider this as just one topos, and we take the full subcategory on this topos on the objects that are either coming from one site or from the other. And then we take Z as the Grothendieck topology induced by the canonical topology on the topos. So in this way, it will necessarily be a subcanonical topology because it is obtained by inducing the canonical topology on a separating set of objects, because you see here, if we take objects which come from one site plus the ones which come from the other site, a fortiori this will give me a separating set for the topos. And therefore, you see, we have that our two canonical functors take values in A. And since Z is a subcanonical, the fact that they induce an equivalence will imply that these canonical functors are dense. Mm? And this is how we can conclude the proof of the result. Okay, so now concerning denseness conditions, we can stop here, even though, of course, we are going to use them in our later results. In particular, we are using them in order to characterize a number of invariant properties of geometric morphisms in site theoretic terms. Okay, so the properties that we are going to consider are the following. We are going to study surjections, inclusions, hyperconnected morphisms, localic morphisms, and local morphisms. So let's start with the surjections and inclusions, which of course are very important kinds of morphisms of toposes, because inclusions correspond to subtoposes, which of course is a very important notion in topos theory. And there is a very nice factorization theorem, which by now is a classical result, which says that surjections and inclusions are orthogonal classes of morphisms, and every geometric morphism can be factored uniquely up to commuting equivalence as the composite of a surjection followed by an inclusion. In particular, given the orthogonality of these two classes of morphisms, we can also characterize equivalences of toposes as morphisms that are simultaneously surjective and an inclusion. In fact, we are going actually to use this characterization in order to derive alternative criteria for equivalences of toposes. But first of all, let's recall what a surjection is, what an inclusion is. A surjection is a geometric morphism whose inverse image is faithful. An inclusion is defined as a geometric morphism whose direct image functor is full and faithful. So typically you see an inclusion is the inclusion of a certain subtopos into a given topos. So you see the full and faithfulness holds because it is a full and faithful inclusion. So you see when you have a subtopos, it always embeds in the topos in a full and faithful way. And in the case of a subtopos, the inverse image is the associated shift functor. So this is why inclusions are typically defined by referring to the direct image functor. In fact, as we shall see, as a result of our analysis, it is possible also to naturally characterize inclusions in terms of inverse image functor. So what we are going to do now is to investigate the morphisms of sites, and then we will also discuss the comorphisms of sites, which induce surjections and inclusions. And we shall also investigate the surjection-inclusion factorization from the site theoretic viewpoint. Okay, so here is the theorem, which provides the desired characterizations. So supposing that we have a morphism of small generated sites, then the geometric morphism induced by it is a surjection, if and only if F is cover reflecting, not the covering lifting property, cover reflection, which means that if the image of a family of arrows is covering in the codomain site, then the family in the domain site is covering. So as you can see, this is very pleasant because you see it shows that this topos theoretic invariant property of being a surjection naturally formulates at the site level in terms of this cover reflection property, which of course in practice is very easy to verify. Okay, very nice is also the description of the surjection inclusion factorization of the geometric morphism induced by F, because it involves a new Grothendieck topology on the domain category, whose description is very, very simple. So the covering sieves are exactly those which are sent by the functor to covering families in the target site. Notice that in general, defining a Grothendieck topology like this for an arbitrary functor F will not work, in the sense that it will not yield a Grothendieck. In general, it will yield a family of sieves, but it will not satisfy all the required properties of a Grothendieck topology. But what this theorem is telling us is that in the particular case where F is a morphism of sites, then by defining a family of sieves in this way, we indeed get a Grothendieck topology. So this is a result which is interesting in its own right, because every time we can define new Grothendieck topologies in a simple way, it is a very good news, because you see there are various Grothendieck topologies associated with functors that one can define. For instance, we have discussed about, you see, the smallest Grothendieck topology on the domain site, which makes the functor a comorphism of sites. And again, we remarked that in general, this topology didn't have a simple description, just a description in terms of generators, but not like a full characterization of the covering sieves. And dually, one is also led to introduce, well, already Grothendieck introduced the notion of induced topology on the domain site by a functor as the largest Grothendieck topology, which makes the given functor continuous. But again, it is not completely easy to get a characterization of this topology, because, I mean, one can get it, of course, by using the results that we presented in the second lecture of the course. You see, this topology can be characterized. Let me just take, yes, here we are. So this topology can be characterized as the collection of all the sieves such that all their pullbacks satisfy this property here in the proposition, this cofinality property here. But you see, it is not a very easy condition to verify, because it involves regarding the connected components of these comma categories. So of course it is not overly complicated, but it is not very easy either. While what is interesting about this induced topology in the case of morphisms of sites is that its description is actually very, very easy, because we take precisely the covering families which are sent by the functor to covering families in the codomain site. But we shall come back to this notion of induced topology in the next slide. For the moment, let's talk about the site characterization of inclusions. Well, here the idea is the following. So you see, whenever you have an orthogonal factorization system, you can characterize the left arrows as the arrows such that when you take the factorization, the right component is an equivalence. And dually for the right arrows. So in this case, we can characterize the inclusions as the morphisms such that when you take the surjection inclusion factorization of them, the surjection part is an equivalent. Now, this is interesting because we have criteria for investigating whether a certain morphism of site induces an equivalence. So we can apply them, in particular, to the functors which to the morphisms which arise in this surjection inclusion factorization. By using this, we conclude immediately that the geometric morphism induced by an inclusion, induced by F, is an inclusion if and only if you see the functor FR, which you see arises in this factorization, is a weakly dense morphism of size. Of course, this becomes particularly interesting when the topology K is subcanonical, in which case weak denseness can be replaced by denseness. So in this particular case, we get, you see here, these two conditions, these two completely easy and explicit conditions for the geometric morphism induced by F to be an inclusion. So if we apply this to just a geometric morphism regarded as a morphism of sites between the the canonical sites of E and F. So you see, when you have a geometric morphism, you can regard its inverse image functor as a morphism between the subcanonical sites. So you can apply the above results in this particular case, and so you get this characterization of inclusions in terms of the inverse image functor, which is actually pretty nice because there are a number of situations in topos theory where direct image functors of morphisms admit a much more complicated expression than the inverse images. Mm? So think, for instance, about the geometric morphisms induced between the slice toposes induced by an arrow between the objects. You see, the direct image is the dependent product functor, which is much more complicated to describe in general than the simple pullback functor, which is the inverse image. Mm? So you see, being able to check whether a morphism is an inclusion by referring to the inverse image is actually very, very useful. Mm? Especially because these two conditions are quite natural after all. So you see, the first condition is a local surjectivity condition. So it says that every object of F can be covered by objects in the image of F upper star. And then we have the second condition, which is a local fullness condition, which you can read there. And in fact, you can even simplify these two conditions by considering families consisting of a single object, because since in a Grothendieck topos you have all coproducts, you can put all these covering families into just one single arrow by considering the coproduct of their domains. And so by applying this construction, we can rewrite in simpler terms these two conditions. So the first condition becomes that every object can be expressed as a quotient of an object in the image of F upper star. And the second condition, you see, it simply requires that any arrow between the images of two objects by the inverse image of F, any arrow can be locally represented as the image of an arrow in the topos E. Mm? So you see here, instead of requiring a whole family or a whole epimorphic family of arrows, you just require an arrow, mm? Which is sent to an epimorphism. So you see that here I am implicitly using the Grothendieck topology induced by F upper star. This is why I have these conditions, which is sent by F upper star to an epimorphic family, mm? Because this is the same as saying that it should be J F upper star covering. Mm? Okay, very good. So now we can say a few words about this induced topology. We had stopped on the topic of the induced topology. So let's recap the definition. So whenever we have a geometric morphism or a flat functor or a morphism of sites, we can always induce a Grothendieck topology on the category C. So this is called the Grothendieck topology induced by the given geometric morphism or flat functor or a morphism of sites. And it is a quite a nice topology because it admits this, it is very useful, of course, as we have seen its role in the surjection inclusion factorization. And it's also quite pleasant because of its quite simple characterization. The covering sieves are precisely those that are sent by the geometric morphism or the flat functor to epimorphic families. In the case, of course, of a morphism of sites, being sent to an epimorphic family in the topos is the same thing as being sent to a covering family in the site. Mm? So in this way we get a Grothendieck topology on C whose covering sieves are exactly those whose image under the given morphism are covering tangi in the codomain site. So I have already observed that this topology actually can be characterized as the largest topology on C, which makes F continuous as a functor from C to the site DK. So in general, this largest topology admits an explicit description, which is more complicated because as we have remarked, we have to require that these cofinality conditions hold for all the pullbacks of the sieves in the topology. So it is particularly pleasant that in this particular case the description simplifies. Okay, so one application of this notion of induced topology is the following corollary, which is a means for establishing equivalences of topologies. So supposing that you have a flat functor and you want to get an equivalence out of it. So what you do is to put the induced topology on C, and then you will have the topos of the sheaves on the corresponding site, which will be of course related to E. And this relationship, this canonical morphism from E will be actually an equivalence if the functor F is J-full and the objects in its image form a separating set of objects for the topos E. So as you can see, this is a very simple criterion for getting an equivalence of topologies. In fact, as a general methodology, what I always suggest to do is to try, I mean, normally when you have a certain intuition that two mathematical situations might have some crucial aspects in common, one should try to build some topologies from these situations which embody the essence of this context, to use Grothendieck's expression. And in most cases, the first topologies you build will not be equivalent, but they will be related by some morphisms. So something that makes a lot of sense to do is to try to obtain from these morphisms that might exist in one direction or in another, or even something more general than a morphism, to try to get equivalences, to try to build equivalences from them. For instance, by using these factorization theorems or by other means. Because you see, whenever you get an equivalence of topologies, then you can transfer a maximal amount of information, you see, between the two presentations. Because essentially any genuine categorical invariant applicable to topologies will be invariant under equivalence of topologies. So this means that automatically you have a great amount of invariants available to investigate from the point of view of the different presentations. While if you have a general morphism that is not an equivalence, then you would need to check whether your given invariant is preserved or not by this equivalent, by this morphism. But in general, you see the invariants that are preserved by morphisms are very few compared to the invariants that are preserved by equivalences. Therefore, as a general research strategy, let's say in topospheory, I always recommend to try to get equivalences from morphisms. And in fact, these factorization results, for instance, this surjection inclusion factorization, or now we are going to see the hyperconnected locality factorization, or even other factorization theorems, are ways very effective ways one can operate with morphisms of toposes in order to manipulate them, to construct new morphisms from known ones, up to the point where one can actually get equivalences and then apply the bridge technique in connection with these equivalences to transfer information between the different presentations. Mm? So of course the bridge technique can also be applied to morphisms, but the problem is, you see, that the key ingredient is to have the invariants available, and the key point is to achieve a unification given by the expression of given invariants in terms of the presentations. So if you don't have an equivalence but just a morphism, you will lose the unification aspect, because it will not be just one property manifesting itself in different ways, but something weaker than that. So conceptually, it will be less illuminating. And also technically, you will have many less invariants. Mm? But this was just a side remark. Mm? Okay, so let's continue with our analysis and talk about hyperconnected and localic morphisms. These notions were introduced by Johnston, who also proved that this nice factorization theorem, saying that every geometric morphism can be factored uniquely up to commutic equivalence as the composite of a hyperconnected morphism followed by a localic one. So how are these classes defined? Well, we say that geometric morphism is hyperconnected if its inverse image functor is full and faithful and its image is closed under subordinate. We say that a geometric morphism is localic if every object of the domain topos is a subquotient, namely a quotient of a subobject, of an object in the image of the functor f of s. So in fact, you might wonder why these morphisms are called localic. Well, in fact, they are precisely the geometric morphisms which correspond to the structure morphisms induced by internal locales in the base topos. Okay, so what we have is that this class of these two classes of morphisms are orthogonal to each other, which is also quite nice. In particular, this allows one to regard an equivalence of toposes as a morphism which is both hyperconnected and localic. And in practice, it is nice also to characterize in this way, because in fact, we can obtain alternative characterizations of equivalences of toposes using this remark. Mm? Okay, so let's have a look at how these invariant properties express in terms of morphisms of size. So as in the case of surjections and inclusions, the reformulations are quite satisfactory. So for instance, if we characterize the continuous flat functors that induce a localic morphism, we get this quite simple property of the functor, namely that the subobjects of objects in its image should form a separating set for the topos. If we want to reformulate this more generally for an arbitrary morphism of sites, well, the condition becomes slightly more complicated, because of course you want to consider subobjects of objects in the image of the corresponding flat functor, and so it arises. So these are not necessarily principal sieves; they are general sieves. And so this is why you get this slightly more complicated expression, but still, I mean, you can effectively work with such a characterization in practice. Mm? Okay, so now let's talk about what happens for the hyperconnected property. So one can show that the geometric morphism induced by a continuous flat functor is hyperconnected if the functor is on the one end cover reflecting, and on the other end, for any subobject of an object in the image of the functor, there should be a sieve on that object, such that A, the given subobject, can be written as the union of the images of the arrows F of F, where F lies among the arrows of this sieve. So as you can see, it is a very, very nice condition, which can be easily checked in practice. Now, if we understand this in terms of morphisms of small generated sites, then of course it becomes, as in the previous case, slightly more sophisticated, in the sense that instead of talking about subobjects of the objects in the image of the flat functor, so we talk about closed sieves. Why? Well, because because you see, when you take, when you want to characterize in site theoretic terms the subobjects of the objects in the image of the canonical functor, what you get is precisely the closed sieves on the given object. This is a quite easy result, which you can find in the monograph. So by using this result, one can characterize the morphisms of small generated sites which induce an hyperconnected morphism as those that are cover reflecting and the closed sieve lifting, which is precisely this this property written in the language of morphisms of sites, but it is just the application of the previous property for flat functors in this case. Now, so as you can see, these topospheretic invariants manifest themselves in a very satisfactory way at the level of sites. We have also obtained a site theoretic characterization of the hyperconnected localic factorization of the geometric morphism induced by a morphism of sites. I have not reported this result because the statement is quite technical, but you can find it in the monograph. In fact, this result yields a particularly elegant description of this factorization when you apply it to the geometric morphism between the classifying toposes of two geometric theories induced by an interpretation of one theory into the other. So remember that interpretations can be defined as morphisms between the syntactic sites of the theories. And so, of course, they induce a geometric morphism between the respective classifying toposes. And in fact, when you apply this hyperconnected localic factorization to such a morphism, you get a very nice theory, a very nice intermediate theory, which gives you the factorization, like a syntactic description of this factorization. It is even simpler when you take just the geometric morphism induced by an expansion of one theory into another. By expansion, I just mean that you add possibly sorts, function symbols, relation symbols, as well as axioms to a given theory. So, of course, in this way, you get an interpretation between the two theories, and this will induce a geometric morphism. If you describe, if you consider the hyperconnected localic factorization of the corresponding geometric morphism, in fact, the intermediate theory, there is an intermediate theory that you can write down explicitly, it's very nice, such that its classifying topos provides precisely this hyperconnected localic factorization. So this was in fact already obtained in my book, Theories, Sites, Toposes. So you can already look at it there. Then in the recent monograph, I have looked more generally at the case of an arbitrary interpretation. Mm-hmm. Okay, so let's go on. In fact, by using these notions of hyperconnected morphism, this notion of like being the image of the inverse image closed under subobjects, one can obtain alternative characterizations for equivalences of topologies as well as inclusions. In fact, the key idea is that you see for having an equivalence, you need in particular the fullness condition for the functor. And provided that the functor is also faithful, in fact, you can understand you can replace the fullness requirement by the closure under subobjects. Mm? Because you see every arrow gives rise to its graph, which is a subobject. So you see this allows you to approach the characterization of equivalences in a different way. And so it leads in particular to this corollary, which provides an alternative criterion for a continuous flat functor to induce an equivalence. So you see the first condition is the same. It is the cover reflecting property. The third condition also is the same. It is the local fullness condition, which is replaced by this one, which is precisely the condition we have discussed earlier, that every subobject of an object of the form f of c can be expressed as unions of the images of the arrows coming from a J-closed sieve. So accordingly, we have alternative characterizations also of inclusions. Mm? So we can characterize the morphisms that are inclusions in terms of their inverse image by requiring that the letter be locally surjective and that its image should be closed under subobjects. Mm? Okay, so I would like to and also, I mean, we can, of course, as I have already mentioned, characterize equivalences as the morphisms such that the inverse image is faithful, locally surjective, and its image is closed under subobject. So you see, this is quite nice because, as you can see, what makes the difference between being an equivalence and being an inclusion is, you see, the condition of the faithfulness condition, which is missing, you see, in the case of inclusions, as it is normal. Mm? But you better understand the relationship between the two notions. Mm? So you see, this is one consequence of this surjection inclusion factorization. So in fact, in the monograph, we have applied this latter corollary to obtain quite elegant characterizations of the interpretations of one geometric theory into another, which identify the letter as a quotient of the former, of course, up to Morita equivalence. And also, we have characterized the interpretations of one geometric theory into another, which induce a Morita equivalence between them. This is also quite useful because in many situations, you find yourself with theories that are related in a natural way, but you wonder whether they give rise to a Morita equivalence or not. In many cases, you have just an interpretation and not a bi-interpretation. And therefore, but this, of course, doesn't prevent you from having a Morita equivalence. A simple example is the theory of MV algebras and the theory of L groups with lattice ordered abelian groups with strong unit. So in this case, you have an interpretation in one direction, but not in the other. So the two theories are not bi-interpretable, but they are Morita equivalent. So you see, in fact, it is useful to dispose of criteria for checking where a certain interpretation induces a Morita equivalence. And you can find these results in the monograph. I have not reported them here, but if you are interested, you can find them there. Okay, now let's finally talk about the possible characterizations that one can establish of these invariant properties of geometric morphisms in terms of comorphisms of sites inducing them. Because so far we have studied the geometric morphisms induced by morphisms of sites. And we have seen that, in fact, these properties characterize very naturally in terms of them. For comorphisms of sites, well, the situation is slightly more complicated because for some of these properties, the characterizations, of course, can be achieved. So there are full characterizations in the monograph for all of these properties, but in most circumstances, they are more technically involved than the ones you obtain for morphisms of sites. So, of course, you see, it depends on the invariants one considers. Some of them can be more naturally characterized from this algebraic perspective of morphisms. Some others are more naturally characterized in terms of comorphisms. Anyway, I have reported here some of the simplest examples of characterizations of the above properties in terms of the comorphisms. And so in this way, you can see that still there are some results that show a quite natural way of rephrasing these conditions also for comorphisms. So the first result is a proposition characterizing the comorphisms which induce a surjection. So in fact, these comorphisms are precisely those such that the topology in the target site, J, can be characterized as the co-induced topology by K under F. So you see, it's always possible to to co-induce a topology on the target site from a functor and a topology on the source site by postulating that a sieve should be covering if when I consider the pullback of it along any arrow whose domain lies in the image of the comorphism, I get a sieve which contains the image of a covering sieve under the functor. So one can always define this topology. And what this result is telling you is that the comorphism induces a surjection if and only if J coincides with this co-induced topology. So here I have written down explicitly what it means. So it means that whenever you have a sieve satisfying the property that all its pullbacks along arrows X of this form contains the image of a covering sieve under F, then this sieve should be J covering. So this condition actually implies the denseness of the J denseness of F, and it can be shown to be equivalent to it if F is cover preserving, which of course can hold or not, depending on the case. Okay, now it is also possible to describe quite naturally the surjection inclusion factorization of the geometric morphism induced by a comorphism F if F is cover preserving. Otherwise, it becomes more complicated. So in this situation, one can describe this factorization at the site level through the introduction of a new site, C prime J prime, where C prime is defined as the full subcategory of C on the objects in the image of F. And J prime is defined as the smallest Grothendieck topology on C prime, making the inclusion I of C prime into C a comorphism. So in this way, of course, we get a functor F prime, which is simply the functor F regarded as a comorphism into this new site. And then on the other end, we have the inclusion functor I. And so one can describe the surjection inclusion factorization in this way. Okay, other results, for hyperconnected morphisms, well, as I have mentioned, in general, characterizing them for an arbitrary comorphism of sites is quite hard. It is complicated. You can find the full results in the monograph, but in order not to scare people too much, I didn't project in these slides. I have just reported some particular cases. So in the case of a functor between essentially small categories and the geometric morphism, the essential geometric morphism induced by it, one can show that this is hyperconnected if and only if the functor F is higher, there is a typo, of course, F is the big F. If and only if the functor is full and every object of D is a retract of an image in, of an object in the image of F. And then we have a site theoretic description of the hyperconnected localic factorization of the geometric morphism induced by a cover preserving comorphism of sites. So in this way, actually, the intermediate category is defined as the quotient of the domain category by the congruence relation induced by the functor F. Then, of course, one can define a sort of quotient Grothendieck topology L on it, whose covering sieves are those sieves whose inverse image under the canonical projection functor is covering in the domain site. And we have obvious functors giving the factorization of F. And in fact, it can be shown that the hyperconnected localic factorization can be realized in this way by taking the morphisms corresponding to this intermediate comorphisms. Okay, finally, I would like to talk about a particularly important class of morphisms, which is particularly relevant in connection with the theory of Gros and Petit toposes in algebraic geometry and beyond, the class of local morphisms. So let's recall that a geometric morphism is said to be local if its direct image functor has a fully faithful right adjoint. So of course, in the literature, you can also find alternative characterizations of these morphisms, but this is the one that we are going to use. Notice that this notion makes sense also for weak morphisms of toposes because you see it refers to the direct image of this, morphism. And so we can also define local weak morphisms. So here is a theorem which concerns a special situation which tends to occur when one wants to build Petit and Gros toposes for certain structures, either topological or algebraic. So this situation is when one has a continuous comorphism of sites, which of course we can also regard as a weak morphism of sites, because remember that we define the weak morphism of sites as a simply continuous functor between these sites. So in this way, we have two morphisms, one induced by the functor regarded as a comorphism, so it is what we had called the CF, and the other morphism, the other weak morphism, which is induced by F regarded as a weak morphism of sites. And we can compare the two morphisms with each other. And so in this way, we get this string of adjunctions. So we see that the essential image of CF can be identified with the inverse image of sheaves on F, of the geometric morphism induced by F as a weak morphism of sides. Then, of course, this is left adjoint to the direct image of this weak morphism, which in turn can be identified with the inverse image of CF, which is just the functor taking the composite with F op, which is again left adjoint to the direct image of this of this morphism induced by F as a comorphism of sides. So we have this situation. Now, suppose that F is a morphism, not just a weak morphism, but a morphism. Then this pair of geometric morphisms actually forms an adjoint pair in the two categorical sense, in the two category of Grothendieck topologies, geometric morphisms and geometric transformations. Of course, this also generalizes to the case of a weak morphism, in which case, instead of taking the two category of Grothendieck topologies and geometric morphisms, you take the two category of Grothendieck topologies and weak morphisms, but it's completely analogous. And then there is this third point of the theorem, which is interesting because it can be applied in many cases, which characterizes the weak morphisms of induced by F that are local in terms of the condition for C of F to be an inclusion. Now, the condition for C of F to be an inclusion, given the fact that F is continuous, can be formulated precisely as the requirement that F should be K-faithful and K-full. So remember about this because we are going to apply it. Okay, so in this situation, we have a canonical geometric transformation. I have told you that they are adjoint in the two categorical sense. And this canonical geometric transformation is actually an isomorphism if and only if we have this K-faithfulness and K-fullness property of F. So supposing that F is a morphism of sides, in fact, our two geometric morphisms realize the topos of sheaves on DK as a coadjoint retract of the topos of sheaves on CJ. So you see, we have this coadjoint retract where one morphism is essential, the other one is local. And so this is a situation where we get an homotopy of toposes, which induces an equivalence, an isomorphism in cohomology, which is actually the setting relevant in the context of Gros and Petit topologies. So let me suggest an application of this into this context. So you see, Gros and Petit topologies refers to a situation where one has a certain Petit topos associated with a geometric object and a Gros topos associated with the same geometric object, and the corresponding toposes are related by a retraction of the kind that we have discussed. So actually, you see, what we can do from our theorem is to start from a K-full and K-faithful morphism and comorphism of sites, from a site DK to a site of a particular form, a relative site, where we suppose to have a category T endowed with a Grothendieck topology E. A particular object of this category that is naturally attached to D, so we call it TD. Of course, then we can induce our Grothendieck topology E on the slice category. And so this is the setting. So suppose you are in a situation where you have such a functor between sites of this kind, and this functor is both a morphism and a comorphism, and moreover is relatively full and relatively faithful. So as a simple example, take DK to be the petite site of a topological space X. So the site of open sets of X with the canonical topology. And you take T to be the category of topological spaces or some suitable small category, including X. And you take the object TD to be X. And you take E to be the open cover topology. So you see in this situation, you have a functor which consists in regarding every open set as the corresponding inclusion into X. So you see that this functor actually is full and faithful. And so this is the situation where you get the grow and petit topos associated with the topological space. So this is a completely classical. A non-classical example, which is quite interesting for the application, is the following one. And here you see really the need for these more general notions of fullness and faithfulness, because suppose you have you want to categorify essentially this construction of the open cover topology, and you want to generalize it at the general site level. So you start with a small generated site, CJ, and you consider the functor L from C to the slice category of the category of Grothendieck topos on the corresponding topos, which sends an object C to the corresponding local homeomorphism. So you see C is sent by the canonical functor to the corresponding object of the topos, and then you can take the relative topos to that. And so this functor actually is not full and faithful, but is J-full and J-faithful. Now you can equip the category of Grothendieck topos with a sort of categorification of the open cover topology, which we have just recalled. So we take the Grothendieck topology generated by the families of local homeomorphisms, which are induced by epimorphic spaces. Then if we do this, we indeed get a J-full and J-faithful morphism as well as comorphisms of sites. So our L gives such a morphism. And therefore, by applying our result, we are able to realize our topos of sheaves on CJ, as a petit topos associated with this gros topos, which can be defined as the topos of sheaves on this relative site, or also equivalently as the slice of this topos of sheaves on the absolute site relative to the given topos. So in fact, this construction is part of a much wider project that I am pursuing with my PhD student Riccardo Zanfa, and where we construct a wall framework for developing relative topos theory using the language of stacks, and which actually allows one to study toposes from a purely geometric viewpoint. For instance, by describing direct images, inverse images of sheaves and stacks vibrationally in a geometric way. And in fact, this problem, for instance, of realizing any topos as a petit topos associated with some gros topos was actually a question explicitly posed by Grothendieck in his lecture course at Buffalo in 1973, and which was recently brought to the public attention by Colin McClarty. So in fact, you see this construction in particular provides an answer to this question by Grothendieck, and more generally our constructions seem to respond to his aspirations to develop a geometrical framework for investigating toposes. Okay, so now I have arrived at the end of this course, so let me give some references. Most of the materials I presented in this course, apart from the basic background, which can be found in the excellent introductory book by McLean and Mordyke, is taken from this monograph draft. Of course, you are very welcome to contact me for any comments you might have on this material, because it is a draft. So the idea, the plan is to turn it into a book quite soon. But of course, I will be very very happy to receive feedbacks on not just the results themselves, but also the possible applications, etc. Then, of course, there are the other two main references concerning the roles of equivalences in connection with the use of them in the bridge technique. And so for this, you may refer to my book and also my habilitation thesis, which can be downloaded from my website. Okay, so I'll stop here, and I think some time remains for questions, if you have them. Thank you very much. Let me also mention that there is a new blog and forum that I have created in order to create a platform to informally discuss about these topics. You are invited to join. For the moment, only the blog is activated, but the forum will be activated next week. So feel free to post any questions on these materials, or more generally about any question around topos you might have. We hope that this could provide a nice place to discuss and to create a community of people interested in these results. Okay. So now time for questions. Maybe I should check the chat.
Yeah, there is one question.
Yeah, exactly. So let me, now I have to open the chat. One second. Here we are, yes. Chat. Yes. No, this is not a small generated site, so you have to change the universe. Yes, definitely it is not. So it doesn't stay in the same set theory as the small site. So certainly you have to change the universe, but you see, so here I am referring to Grothendieck universes, but you see when you change the universe, actually all the operations like the shiftification happen in a compatible way. Mm? So of course, if you consider shifts with values in a certain universe, and if you pass to a bigger universe, in principle, the topos will not be the same. It will be something bigger, as you can expect. But all the operations of associated shift functor, etc., so these limits and colimits, they will be compatible. Mm? So the idea is that when you have to go to a higher complexity in terms of size of objects, I think the most reasonable device to use is the universes. And so you go to a suitably large universe and then you work inside it. Mm-hmm. And inside this universe, all these techniques should work as we have seen. Mm-hmm. Okay, then there is another question. So this proposition is like initial topologies in top. I wonder if there exists the dual proposition final topologies, because the Grothendieck topologies over C is a complete lattice One can say that the categories of Grothendieck is like topological category. I'm not sure I understand. So maybe if you want to talk, you can explain a little bit better what you mean.
Excuse me, this yes. question or this comment. I'm not sure, but it's motivated by the slides in which you present induced topology. Yes? Mm-hmm. Yes?
Induced topology. Well, in fact, maybe you are referring to the induced topology on the slice category, right?
Yes.
Okay. No, so the induced topology on the slice category actually coincides with the topology. Let me take it in the slice. So when we introduced this, one second, here we are. So you see it is...
In the slice about induced topology.
I realized that the terminology could be potentially confusing. So these are induced in the sense of, these are topologies, no, let me just, these are the topologies, the smallest topologies which make the functory homomorphism.
No, there is, you have the slides with the title induced topology.
It is induced in the sense that you see it is a vibration, so it is a discrete vibration, and so I put this this topology here. You see M A K in the case of a vibration. So this is actually the topology I put.
Okay, excuse me.
Yeah.
In the slide that I told you is. You say
discrete vibration. Yeah.
There is another slice with the title induced topologies.
Another slice. What are you referring to? Another slide.
Excuse me. I think he wants you to go to the slide where you. Talked about that. The title of the slide should be induced topology. Is that right?
The title of yes. One second. Induced. Yes. Here we are. Yeah.
Yes. Yes. Uh-huh. Okay. You take a geometric morphism.
Yes.
And you construct the Grothendieck topology. Over C, yes?
Yes.
Because the Grothendieck topologies over C is a lattice complete,
uh-huh.
You can take not only one, but a family of geometric morphisms at the beginning. And you can construct, the best Grothendieck topology in uh-huh. order yes this proposition in this proposition you can replace F by the family yes
okay that's the question like instead of having a single geometric morphism this is what you are asking
yes.
Yes, I suppose, yes, of course, because, you have coproducts in the category of Grothendieck topologies, which allow you to, you see, when you have a family of morphisms, you can associate with them a single morphism, and then you can apply this proposition.
Okay. It lies in topology, in categorical topology. Excuse me. Okay, thank you. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Yeah. OK. Okay. Any other questions or comments?
I have a small, probably naive question. So probably related with the last thing you said about this geometric framework to talk about topos.
Yes.
Because you know we have this other this other notion of there being topos. Like they look like, you know, schemes somehow, because we need to introduce kind of the structure shifts. So the naive question is that, I mean, many of the results you have here apply to this in topos or can be extended to this in topos, and this should be related with this, you know, geometric framework with the stacks you're trying to develop.
Yes, so can you repeat, because I didn't hear very well the term. So which topos in geometry
ring topos. So you have this topos and you have this structure shift, this additional structure shift there.
Ah, ringed. Ah, yes. No, sorry, I didn't get the word. Ah, yes, of course. Yes, no, because you see, the way we understand ringed topos is relative topos, where the base is the classifying topos for the theory of rings.
Ah, I see.
Yeah,
So that's like a particular case here. Yeah. Because, you know, probably looking for applications, I think it is kind of, I mean, I was, for example, thinking in this, this arithmetic psi constructed by Kahn and Consani, and
how to
apply this kind of, you know, understanding you are developing with, I mean, in this framework, just to understand this kind of arithmetic questions or this kind of.
Yes, in fact, if you want a very natural thing that could be done in the context of Kahn and Consani's work is to take as base topos the arithmetic topos.
Okay.
And to do things relatively to that. But you see, the problem is that so far we have not disposed of a good relative theory of topos, because category theorists have tried to develop it, but with, in my opinion, the wrong theoretical framework, because they tried to do it with internal sites. So internal sites are very rigid objects. And for instance, they don't even cover the case of the canonical stack of a topos. So you see, these are split stacks, and it's important not to restrict to those stacks. So as a result, I mean, they didn't, they were not successful, to say it briefly, in this project. And so one has to do everything in the right language, which is the language of stacks, rather than that of internal sites. So, I mean, what we hope with Riccardo is to finish this project in 3 or 4 months maximum, because we have already written more than 100 pages. So we are halfway through the project. And then once this theory will be completed, it will be really possible to apply it and to reason in a very geometrical, vibrational way, which is what geometers do. Because you see, we have taken inspiration to design our theory from the paper by Jean Giraud, student of Grothendieck, this paper classifying topos, which in fact was written at the same time as his thesis Cohomologie non abelienne. So actually these ideas come back to that. But you see what happened is that Giraud brought this very nice paper, and the category theorists should have followed that paper and should have developed things in that spirit. And instead, they decided to take a completely different route because they were guided by this ideology of internal sites, which makes sense as an ideology, but not really as a mathematically effective way of doing things. So in the end, they proved some results. They proved, for instance, a relative version of Diaconescu's theorem. But all of this is very, very hard to apply in practice, because you see, when you have an internal site, you have just one object of objects, one object of arrows, and you don't have the indexed approach in terms of generalized elements. So you don't externalize things. And so in the end, it becomes just a nightmare. So it is not, in my opinion, a theory for the working mathematician. So we are trying to build a theory for the working geometer in particular.
Okay, that's really nice. I mean, we're waiting for
yeah, thanks. Thank you very much for organizing this course. And I'm very grateful, very happy to have been able to present all this material. I hope it will, it was not too full of details. I mean, I hope it was understandable, more or less.
So. Actually, I want to thank you actually for your beautiful course and everybody for, you know, attending. And it's very nice. I mean, Olivia already told us that there is this new blog, so we can keep in touch.
Yes, of course. Please contact me through this platform, and we will enjoy talking together about all of this.
Okay. So if no questions or comments, so let's thank Olivia again. And okay.
Okay.
See you until the next time.
Yeah, thanks you all for attending. It has been a great pleasure. Hope to see you on the forum. Bye.
Okay. Bye.